I get where I'm going. And I see my maker's face. I'll stand forever in the light of his amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going.
Good evening. It's Wednesday, April 14th, 2021. I'm Joe, pastor at First Presbyterian Church here in Smithfield, North Carolina, and I welcome all of you as we gather here in the heart of Johnson County to share tonight's reflection and to share in God's good news for all of us. I'm thankful for the opportunity to come to you as I continue this sort of short week series on conversations, sacred conversations and holy conversations. I began the week talking about conversations we have in the eternal now, people with people in our past, our present, our future. Yesterday, I talked about what it means to speak with those and be in relationship with those around us. Tonight takes a very different kind of turn, and one that may take a little more reflection for all of us, especially me. But I'm going to begin with my favorite childhood Sunday school story. That was taught. It's rarely preached on in the Bible, but if I were to give it a short title, it would be The King, the Prophet, and the Witch of Endor. Let us listen together. This is from 1 Samuel chapter 28, beginning at verse 3. Let's listen for God's word to us. Now Samuel had died, and all Israel had mourned for him and buried him in Ramah, his own city. Saul had expelled the mediums and the wizards from the land. The Philistines assembled and came and encamped at Shunem. Saul gathered all Israel and they encamped at Gilboa. When Saul saw the army of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart trembled greatly. When Saul inquired of the Lord did not answer him, not by dreams, not by Urim, or by prophets. Then Saul said to his servants, "Seek out for me a woman who is a medium, so that I may go to her and inquire of her." His servants said to him, "There is a medium at Endor." So Saul disguised himself and put on other clothes and went there, and he and two men with him. They came to the woman by night, and he said, "Consult a spirit for me, and bring up for me the one whom I name to you." And the woman said to him, "Surely you know what Saul has done, and how he has cut off the mediums and the wizards from the land. Why then are you laying a snare for my life to bring about my death?" But Saul swore to her by the Lord, "As the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing." And then the woman said, "Whom shall I bring up for you?" He answered, "Bring up Samuel for me." And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried out with a loud voice, and she said to Saul, "Why have you deceived me? You are Saul." The king said to her, "Have no fear. What do you see?" And the woman said to Saul, "I see a divine being coming up out of the ground." He said to her, "What is his appearance?" She said, "An old man is coming up. He is wrapped in a robe." So Saul knew that it was Samuel, and he bowed with his face to the ground, and he did homage. And then Samuel said to Saul, "Why have you disturbed me by bringing me up?" And Saul answered, "I am in great distress, for the Philistines are warring against me, and God has turned away from me and answers me no more, either by prophets or by dreams. So I have summoned you to tell me what I should do." And Samuel said, "Why then do you ask me, since the Lord has turned from you and become your enemy? The Lord has done to you just as he spoke by me, for the Lord has torn the kingdom out of your hand and given it to your neighbor David. Because you did not obey the voice of the Lord and did not carry out his fierce wrath against Amalek, Therefore, the Lord has done this thing to you today. Moreover, the Lord will give Israel along with you into the hands of the Philistines. And tomorrow you and your son shall be with me. The Lord will also give the army of Israel into the hands of the Philistines. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. It's a strange and difficult story to begin with. We hear the anointed of God, King Saul, is no longer hearing from God. The voice is gone, the Holy Spirit. He's not hearing anything through dreams, nor through the Urim and Thummim, sort of an ancient biblical eight ball in the form of dice that helped you make decisions. He's not hearing from the prophets. He's lost the one who spoke to him in truth, his prophet Samuel. Samuel has died, and he can no longer just turn to him or call him up and say, "Hey, I need you. Tell me what we need to do." And regardless of what anybody said to him, Saul always knew Samuel would tell him the truth. But with Samuel's death, he didn't know what to do. So suddenly he is calling on what we, in a more modern interpretation, call sorcery or witchcraft. He is consulting a medium. Now, if you grow up in the Christ-haunted South, to quote a famous author, you know that we take dealing with the spirits very carefully. We respect them. Whatever beliefs or traditions we have, we take that kind of talk very seriously. And Saul had done what God asked him to do in believing in the law, but what does he do when he loses or cannot hear God's voice any longer? He turns to a medium to summon up Samuel from the dead. Now, I've always called this the Witch of Endor story. I've referred to it several times tonight and will continue probably to do so. And no, I'm not talking about a little teddy bear-like witch woman who lives on a planet on a galaxy far away like an Ewok. I confess I do envision that sometimes just to lighten the mood, because this is a dark story in many ways. Nor is it a fictional witch king from a Tolkien tale. That's too scary for even me to think about. It's the stuff of nightmares. But this medium, this Witch of Endor, she was a real living person that is part of our faith story and imparts a lesson for us tonight. And I learned something new, that even though I've called her the witch so often in life, King James Version, our Revised Standard Version, the new Revised Standard Version that we have used for the past 300 or 400 years, they don't even refer to her as a witch. I have no idea where that came from. But what we learn from what we read and what is actually there, even in English translation, it is said she's a person with a familiar spirit, the kind of person who was banished from the kingdom of Israel by Saul. She's a medium. We may be more familiar with the people who gather around a table and do a seance and conjure up spirits. And as I said, growing in the South, you're real careful when you talk about those things. But this character, this real living person in Saul's own time, a person of bone and flesh, she's actually the most decent, good character in the story. She lives in fear of the Lord. She lives in fear of the king. And not terror, but respect. Certainly in terror of Saul's banishment. But she knows what's what. It's old King Saul who has lost the ear of the Lord. Now, this is definitely a tale we don't have all the pieces. Now, as a 21st century reader, we perhaps, along with others, recognize as we read the issues that Saul dealt with, his fits of madness, that perhaps he suffered very seriously from a mental illness that he himself could not help. And in his own age, there were no resources to treat as we might have been able to help him now or help one another now. But he ends up in the hands of a medium who consults with the dead. She's a smart, savvy lady, and she puts two and two together pretty quickly. This is no unknown stranger who has come to her. This is King Saul. And when he says, "Summon for me Samuel," she knows what's what, and her life is on the line. Sort of a reverence and fear of the Lord. So what a night and a holy week of holy conversations to what I dredged this dark story up. Saul conversing with the dead, that dead prophet Samuel. Let me give you a brief other perspective. Here's a New Testament rendering that may help shine some light literally on the story. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and his brother John, led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. So Matthew 17, verses 1 through 3. We know this story as a good, hopeful story, perhaps a prescient vision of what the resurrection is about. We see Peter, James, and John see Jesus as he truly is, an intersection between heaven and earth. And interesting, in this intersection, he speaks with those who have gone before him, the saints of Jewish tradition, you know, Moses, who gave them the law, and Elijah, the quintessential prophet. Now, in Jewish tradition, we believe Elijah's still walking the earth, but in any event, he would have been incredibly old, older than anyone we have ever known. But Jesus is there talking with those who have provided and shaped the identity of the children of God. And what's even more fascinating to me is that Peter, James, and John, in this intersection between heaven and earth, understand it. They recognize it. Just as Saul recognized Samuel, just as this medium of Endor recognized Samuel when he rose out of the ground from where he had descended to the dead. Jesus is speaking as if in counsel. Saul is seeking counsel because he no longer is able to hear the word of the Lord. You and I, we miss the counsel of those who have departed from us. Even a good people of faith, even believing with joy and hope in the resurrection, we miss the counsel of parents who have been close to us, grandparents, uncles and aunts, teachers, wise friends who have departed. Especially probably in the trying times of this past year when the world feels as if it's closed in around us, yet we feel so isolated. The lens of Easter helps us to understand in this encounter, especially with Jesus, with Moses, Elijah, that it's not just the law and the prophets represented, that Jesus is indeed the living word and is of the God of the living. He speaks with living saints. Peter and James and John recognize them. Saul himself, with the help of a nameless wish, which he's banished, understands that God is a God of the living. And even though when he summons him and Samuel's unhappy, like, why have you bothered me? And he comes with even worse bad news, and Saul probably regretted that he summoned him, saying, you know, you'll be with me along with your family tomorrow. And he was after the battle. But Samuel speaks the truth. Elijah speaks the word of the Lord in truth. Moses gives us the law in truth. One passage tonight. There is so much more I could say about, but I have to stop somewhere. Preachers can go on, and I'm no different than others. But remember, the Easter message is this. Jesus is the message of life and a new beginning, and an eventual homecoming for all the beloved of God. And if you doubted Jesus in this encounter, he refuted his own critics with their own wisdom and their own worldly knowledge of how they understood Scripture with these words. Mark 12, verse 26. And as for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses in the story about the bush how God said to him, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is God not of the dead, but of the living. And that's good news. Tonight I share with you a Catholic prayer of the dead, a little removed from our tradition, but I think beautifully brings together the themes of conversations with the past, people who live in the moment of the eternal now. Let us pray. In your hands, O Lord, we humbly entrust our sisters and brothers. In this life, you embrace them with your tender love. Deliver them now from every evil and bid them to eternal rest. The old order has passed away. Welcome them and us into paradise, where there will be no more sorrow, no weeping or pain, but the fullness of peace and joy with your Son and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. May the Holy Spirit bring us comfort at night, the light of Christ illumine us, and in that light may the love of Christ abide within us. And above all, the peace of God be with you until we can be together again. Good night.